Once again, the Helihela Gorge saw the start of the 24th Umkamaas Canoe Marathon. This, the premier long-distance whitewater canoeing event, started on the first morning with frantic activity as last-minute checks were done on both craft and competitors. The more than 200 entries included some of the country's finest paddlers who had started in batches, just above the Helihela road bridge for the first time in 3 years since flood conditions cut off access to this area. Soon after the start, the front boats, already spread out, were being led by Rice and Simpkins into the approaches to number one rapid. This rapid, occurring so early in the race, has a reputation for unsettling both novice and seasoned crew alike, with few paddlers not experiencing a feeling of apprehension on dropping into it.
Were number one to occur further down the river, it wouldn't cause such a problem, but coming less than 10 minutes after the start, crews had not yet settled down completely into their boats.
Some crews chose to take a more conservative approach by walking or slipping around in an effort to preserve their boat. Leading single Andre Buerta drops in, making it all look easy, whilst others battled the turbulent roller coaster ride, which has many of the less fortunate competitors gasping for breath. Number two rapid saw several of the top crews go out of contention. When bad lines through the last drop saw Harrowfelt and Monteith pinned sideways, and Perro and Evans almost lost the nose of their boat after hitting a rock.
Number two has undergone a major change since the floods, with a new very steep drop having formed at the bottom of the rapid. This is catching out a lot of crews, as it is impossible to see the correct line through the drop from the top. So unless one has paddled this section since the floods, it's a case of shooting it blind.
Previous winners Scott and McCormack took a swim, whilst juniors Brataseth and Redman glided past, showing that age and experience are no guarantee to a safe passage. The damage to Perro and Evans's boat needed some attention, costing them valuable time and effectively putting them out of contention. But back up front, all the local eyes were on Rice and Simpkins as they led through the notorious number 5 and 6 rapids. The battle for fourth place was between John and Andrew Edmonds, closely followed by Richard Starr and Kevin White. The river is always quick to punish a lack of concentration, and you're extremely lucky if you don't lose your boat, as happened to Tony Hackland. Further downstream, in the middle of number 8 rapid, we saw Tim Cornish in a very unfamiliar role in the front of the boat, with his partner Trevor Skeppers concentrating grimly in the back.
This is another section which has changed completely as a result of the floods. In years to come, the river will carve a distinct channel down the rapid, but at the moment, we have what is effectively a very new river, with no clear lines, just a mass of turbulent water caused by a profusion of small rocks in the riverbed.
But it was Grant Wollaston and Ken Reynolds, looking relaxed and paddling strongly, who worked their way up through the field into the lead at the overnight stop at St. Elmo's in a time of 2 hours and 50 minutes, a mere half a boat length ahead of Sean Rice and Colin Simpkins in second place, with Chalupski and McGregor in third place.
Grant did very well. It was nice level, and we took it easy, and things went well.
Grant, you, the guy in the front, was any of the rapids difficult in particular?
Well, number 2, 5 and 6, and mainly 7, but we just cruised with our eyes on the front guys the whole time, Colin Simpkins and Sean Rice. We kept him in sight, kept in contact, and just basically kept it relaxed, and we just started catching, and then we realised we were still strong at number 8, and after that we just kept on going, keeping a nice even pace, and we just managed to catch the guys and come in just ahead of Sean and Colin.
As the sun drops below the cliffs, cooling the valley, wary crews work to repair the results of the day's indiscretions and close encounters with the rocks and the river.
Yeah, we hit a rock there that wasn't supposed to be there. It was about 3 foot high, and we came to an absolute dead stop, so it was quite something. But we were just about sinking. I mean, thank goodness we stopped here. Another 2 kilometers down, we would have had to get out and start. That would have been the end of the race for us.
And you got it fixed for tomorrow?
We're going to be sitting for another 2 or 3 hours, I think, doing some work on the boat this afternoon.
And the long open stage is tomorrow, Helen?
We're just going to have to grind them. We're going to have to go at one pace the whole way, and hopefully after each hour we're going to take 20 seconds. The next hour we'll take 30 seconds out of them. We just slowly grind our way back to the front.
Elsewhere on the camp, competitors relaxed, whilst in the medical tent, others needed attention to repair damaged bodies or to rest weary muscles. The normally unspoilt river bank was littered with boats as the second day dawned cool and overcast. The slower boats from the previous day were let off first in batches, with the faster crews starting in their elapsed time positions at the back of the field, thereby giving the paddlers ample time to contemplate what the day held in store. Overnight leaders Grant Williston and Ken Reynolds started, with Sean Rice and Colin Simpkins in close company, whilst Oscar Chalipsky and Barry Hayward, who'd had a troublesome first day, came under starters' orders and were set off in pursuit of the leaders. Conditions on the second day differ from the first in that the river widens and flattens with less gradient and subsequently fewer rapids and slower moving water. Veteran paddlers John Oliver and Han van Arden experienced a problem when Han's splash cover came off in a rapid, allowing the boat to fill up and gradually sink.
Here we see a potentially dangerous situation where a paddler in his boat is held by a standing or stopper wave. The water flows over a rock and then recirculates upstream, causing the boat to be trapped between the downstream river flow and the upstream recycling water. Fortunately, assistance was at hand and the water shallow enough to allow the paddler to kick out of his boat and stand below the rapid.
Oscar Chalipsky, trying too hard to catch up to the leaders, made an uncharacteristic error of judgment, causing the boat to flip over, putting him and his partner even further out of contention. Meanwhile, Rob Stewart and partner enjoyed themselves thoroughly through one of the roller coaster sections on the second day. They were closely followed by Charles Mason, who, having completed 22 marathons, was by far the most seasoned campaigner in the race. Following soon after, and powering their way through the field of slower boats, were Grant Williston and Ken Reynolds, who had Herman Chalipsky and Lee McGregor a mere 100 metres behind them in second position, after Sean Rice and Colin Simpkins had dropped out of contention when Rice broke a paddle. The tussle for third position was still raging between Richard Starr and Kevin White, the Jamieson brothers, and the Edmonds brothers, with only seconds separating them for most of the race. Williston and Reynolds continued to paddle strongly and started to build up a lead of several minutes. The composure of veteran paddlers Graham Pope Ellis and Johan Klassen can be seen as they negotiate the side chute of 4 foot drop, in contrast to another competitor who gets it all wrong and discovers, to the detriment of various parts of his anatomy, just how many rocks are lining the riverbed. Tom Pike, the oldest competitor in the race, successfully paddled through 4 foot drop, showing the younger generation how it should be done. With the finish a few kilometres away, members of the first aid team were on hand at the last obstacle in the race, in Pompomani Rapid, to cheer Williston and Reynolds on as they powered their way through to the finish line. With the strain starting to show, Chalipsky and McGregor suffer a momentary slip in concentration, but they regain control with just a few hundred metres to go. Tired but elated, Williston and Reynolds crossed the finish line in a time of 6 hours, 44 minutes and 53 seconds, almost 9 minutes ahead of Chalipsky and McGregor, with the Jamieson brothers a further 2.5 minutes behind them and only 30 seconds ahead of fourth-placed Starr and White. A successful event which lived up to every expectation.